Hi, I'm Annabelle Gurwitch. I'm an author, actress, and a patient advocate because I'm someone who is living with lung cancer. And I'm here today on Hope with Answers with Dr. David Carbone from The Ohio State University. And I'm so glad for you to join us. We're going to talk about living with lung cancer. And as you know, David, is it okay if I call you?
Of course.
Okay, thank you. Thank you. As you know, because we've talked, I was diagnosed with found something on a scan in the spring of 2020. And over the next few months, like all of us who get a diagnosis of lung cancer, we go through a process of finding out more and more. And I found out I had stage 4 lung cancer with an EGFR mutation. So that's the first piece of information I get. And then as we go along on this journey, I hate that word journey, but we find out more information about things that I've been told are called sub-mutations. So then I find out I'm an exon 21, but it's a lot of information. And my first question for you today is, what do you do with that information as a patient?
So first of all, you are not an exon 21 mutation. Your tumor has an
Thank
EGFR
you. Thank you
exon 21
distinction.
Mutation.
I appreciate that.
And alterations in the EGFR that drive lung cancer were some of the first alterations that were found to be actionable, for which we have drugs that are highly effective. But it is true that there are different types of mutations that occur to drive tumors. And you said yours is an exon 21. That's one of the most common ones. The other really common one is called an exon 19 deletion.
Right.
And those are both very effectively treated by the first line treatment with a drug called osimertinib. Mm-hmm. But we now know that there are dozens and dozens of other types of mutations in EGFR that can cause lung cancer. Some of them are responsive to the drugs that we have and some are not. Now, one of the more common ones is an exon 20 insertion mutation. And fortunately, research and clinical trials have now found effective treatments for those mutations as well. So it's a very exciting time in treating lung cancer.
So as you get a diagnosis and the more information you get, this is the importance. What we're talking about is really the importance of biomarker testing and continued biomarker testing, right? Because that's one of the wily things about lung cancer, isn't it, that I've learned, which is that you can start out with a certain kind of mutation, but then that mutation can change. And how does a patient know that's happening? Is that when you see progression, or what are the signs of that?
So first of all, biomarker testing has revolutionized the management of lung cancer, and it's something that should be done before any treatment is chosen, mm-hmm. because we now have many different alterations that determine the most effective treatments available. And you're absolutely right that once you start on a biomarker-directed therapy, cancers develop resistance, and they do that by generating new mutations in the same gene, mutations in other genes, developing bypass pathways, or changing, or as I heard this morning referred to as shapeshifting. So EGFR mutant lung cancers can start out looking like what we call adenocarcinomas, most uh-huh. of them do. But it can change shape into looking more like a small cell tumor in the process of becoming resistant. So I think it is important, if the cancer starts to grow, if you have worsening symptoms from your cancer, or if the scans show growth, that an additional biopsy be done to really try to determine the mechanism that the cancer has used to avoid responding to the therapy. And it's potentially targetable as well.
As we learn, the importance of the information and continued testing And being a good patient advocate is making sure that even though it should be a standard of care, that these things get, you get this biomarker testing and know that that can potentially change, because this precision targeting, targeted medication will change over time, right? Because depending upon the different sub-mutations.
Right, so the most important thing is getting the testing up front, mm-hmm. and knowing which type of driver a particular tumor has. And it is possible for there to be changes in therapy that are driven by defining the new mutations that are acquired by the tumor in the process of becoming resistant. But it's also true that sometimes these tumors, they present in 20 different locations around your body. That makes them stage four. But sometimes it's only one spot that grows. And in that case, you don't change the therapy that's suppressing the other 19. You can target that one spot with a local therapy like stereotactic radiation and continue the primary therapy as long as possible.
Well, one thing you just talked about, which we were talking about, we are at a Lung Cancer Foundation of America conference, we were talking about shape shifting, and this was some new information for me, that an EGFR mutation form of lung cancer can shape shift into small cell lung cancer. Is that correct?
Yeah, that's correct.
How does that happen, and why does that happen? What do you do?
So basically, it's the way a tumor looks under the microscope, and then the types of chemotherapy that are likely to be responsive, that likely cause a response. But the fact is that the tumor, even though it looks like a different type of tumor, it still has the EGFR mutation in general. Mm-hmm. So molecularly, it's very similar to what was started. But the tumor has acquired additional characteristics that make it resistant to the osimertinib or whichever therapy it's on. And most people would treat that with the therapy for small cell, which is chemotherapy.
There's one last question I wanted to ask you, which is something you just alluded to. So drug resistance. So right now, in terms of the biomarker targeted therapies, there's a difference in between being what would be like right now in those therapies, there's a kind of a, what is it? It's we're looking at suppressing the disease, but not curing the disease, if that would be the right
terminology. Yeah, this is
terminology.
These kinds of therapies have been dramatic advance in the treatment of lung cancer, with historically survivals in the few month range, 4 to 6 months. And now we're seeing with these targeted therapies many years, but the fact is that that's still not a cure.
That's the next frontier.
And the most of these treatments will become ineffective if the patient lives long enough. And I think the next frontier of research is to figure out how to make these responses deeper and more durable, or hopefully even curative in the future by understanding why all the tumor isn't killed off with these targeted therapies in the first place, and better understanding resistance.
Well, I know you have clinical trials in place right now, so I'm sure that no pressure, but
well, there's lots of pressure.
Though.
I mean, these are patients' lives
Yes.
that we're talking about.
Yes.
And as a cancer survivor myself, I understand the urgency that people want the new treatments now. But it is true that the clinical trials of today are tomorrow's standard of care. And patients should be aware that they should seek out what's available for clinical trials at every step in their cancer, you don't like the term, journey.
Yes. In their cancer travels, let's just say. Listen, thank you so much for making this information so digestible. Thanks for watching us today with Hope with Answers.